Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2020 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. We have apologies this morning from Alec Rowley. I'd like to welcome our new member to the committee, Alistair Allan, and welcome to this meeting and invite him to declare any relevant interests. Alistair Allan?
Thank you, convener, for your welcome. I don't have any particular interest to declare, but would refer people to my register of interest.
Okay, thank you, Alistair. Very grateful. Can I also put on record our thanks to George Adam for all his hard work during his time on the committee. The second item on our agenda this morning is to take evidence on the pre-budget scrutiny from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. This session will focus on their analysis of HMRC's 2018-19 Scottish income tax data outturn figures and forecast evaluation report and evaluation of income tax forecasts for 2018-19. I welcome you all to the meeting. Can I welcome Professor Francis Breeden, who's a commissioner, Professor David Ulph, who's also a commissioner, Claire Murdoch, who's the head of Social Security and Public Funding, and David Stone, who's the head of Economy and Tax. I wonder if Professor Francis Breeden could please begin his evidence session with any opening remarks that the SFC might wish to make. Thank you.
Just briefly, I will hand over to David shortly, but just to say, the way we're planning this event is, you know, I will be fielding the questions, so David will make the opening statement, but I will try and manage the questions when they've come. Anyway, hand over to David now.
Okay, thanks, Francis.
Okay, good morning, and thank you for asking the Fiscal Commission to give evidence. At the start of September, we published our main forecast evaluation report covering our devolved taxes and Social Security spending forecasts for 2019-20. It did not include an assessment of our income tax forecast because, due to COVID, HMRC had delayed publishing their income tax outturn data from its usual publication date in July. On the 23rd of September, HMRC published its income tax outturn data for 2018-19. We wrote to the convener on the 23rd with an initial assessment, and on the 5th of October, we published our income tax evaluation. I should add that both our evaluation reports cover the pre-COVID-19 period. I'd briefly like to cover a few points from our income tax evaluation. Income tax funding in the 2018-19 Scottish Budget was set using our forecast of Scottish income tax revenue and also a forecast of the Block Grant Adjustment, which in turn was based on the OBR's forecast of income tax revenue in the rest of the U.K. With the publication of outturn data for 2018-19, we now have final values for 2018-19 Scottish income tax revenues and the BGA. Differences between our budget setting forecast and outturn, and similarly differences between the budget setting and final BGAs, will be corrected through a negative reconciliation of 309 million to the Scottish Budget for 2021-22. So where did this 309 million figure come from? I think the simplest way to understand it is by looking at the forecast on outturn growth rates. As you are aware, what really matters for income tax funding in the Scottish Budget is the growth rate of income tax revenues in Scotland since the initial deduction year 2016-17, compared to the growth rate of income tax revenues in the rest of the U.K. for the same period. Now, our forecast in February 2018 predicted Scottish income tax revenue growing by 8.6% between 2016-17 and 2018-19. Outturn data shows tax revenues actually grew by 7.8%. So we overestimated growth in Scottish income tax revenues. The income tax BGA was forecast to grow by 4.8%, with the outturn data showing it actually grew by 6.7%. The growth in the BGA was underestimated when the budget was set. Our moderate overestimate of growth in Scottish income tax revenues and the moderate underestimate of growth in the BGA both reinforced each other, resulting in the negative reconciliation. Before putting some numbers on this, I need to say a bit more about the errors in forecasting both Scottish income tax and the associated BGA. When we made our February 2018 forecast, we did not have accurate outturn data on Scottish income tax revenues in 2016 and 17. This data only became available in July 2018. Of our headline forecast error of 621 million, we estimate that around 538 million arose because of the lack of historic outturn data. Had we had historic outturn, accurate outturn data to work from, we calculate that our forecast error would have been closer to 83 million, or less than 1%. This data issue had no direct effect on the Scottish budget or reconciliations, since the forecast of the BGA was also affected by the error arising from the data issue, and the two effects cancelled out. So of the 309 million reconciliation, we believe that our forecast error contributed 83 million and the error in the forecast of the BGA contributed 207 million. Finally, following a request from this committee last year, alongside our income tax forecast evaluation report, we also recently published a paper looking at the effect of the distribution of income on the growth of income tax revenues, and we'd be happy to discuss that with you today. And with that, I'll hand back over to you, convener, for the question and answer session. My fellow Commissioner Francis Breeden will coordinate our answers.
Thank you very much, David. Could we just begin with some of the numbers you've been going over there, particularly the reconciliation figure of 309 million. And I just want to get some stuff on the record so that people understand why we've gone from a forecast reconciliation in 18-19 of a negative reconciliation of 555 million now to 309 million. So we've been over some of this territory before, and we asked you whether the negative reconciliations were likely to significantly change when the outturn figures for 2018-19 were published. The SFC responded by saying that we are now close enough to having final figure to say we would be surprised if it was very different, and that this year's £204 million figure settled down into that area sometime before we had the final outturn figures. He added that it would be certainly wise for the Scottish Government to assume that next year's reconciliation figure will be in the area of 550 million, rather than to hope that it will turn out to be very different, which is unlikely. As we know, as you've described already, David, the reconciliation figure of 309 million is just over half that 555 forecast figure, which you told us in February you were surprised if it was very different. I think it would be helpful to explain to people just a bit more about what was going on and the change between these two figures. And I know that Francis is going to feel that first, initially at least.
Okay, yeah, thanks for that question. Yeah, so just to give you the mechanics of what happened, and then I'll get on to the other issues. So The outturn for 17-18 was very weak. So when we were undertaking our forecast, we sort of projected that weakness in 2017-18 would continue. But in fact, what has happened is that in the 18-19 data, there has been a significant bounce back in tax receipts, and so that's why the reconciliation has changed, and that bounce back was not what we initially predicted. So that's the mechanics of what happened, that we were expecting another relatively weak outturn and got a significant bounce back instead. In terms of the question, I think, if we gave the wrong impression of the committee, we certainly would apologize for that. I think the point we were trying to make is, and I think we did say a number of times this was a forecast, unless you know, us not always entirely accurate. And I think the point we maybe were trying to make is the one you made, which is, even though this is a forecast, this is something that should be considered in budget settings. So when you're in budget for the year, should consider the fact that there may be this reconciliation, and the forecast reconciliation is an important piece that should be considered, because although on this occasion reconciliation fell, there may be another occasion when actually the reconciliation will get bigger in when we get the final outturn data. So I think maybe we were trying to make that point, and maybe we incorrectly gave the impression to the committee that meant that we were very firm about the data. I think we, and I think on other occasions we explained it was a forecast, but we apologise if we gave the wrong impression.
Certainly, I wasn't looking for an apology, Francis, just an explanation.
I think
you're pretty well there. If you don't mind, can we just spend a wee bit of time also looking at figure two in your supplementary evaluation report on your forecast for income tax in 18-19? Puzzles me a wee bit, and I think it would be helpful just to get some clarity. My main issue is why the forecast error falls from 0.9% in December 18 to 0.6% in May 19, but then rises again to 1.6% in February 20. And I think it's be useful again, just for the public record, that we can explain how a forecast error more than doubled in that period after the end of the tax year. You're forecasting when actually much of the outcome data, especially in relation to PYE, would have been available.
Yeah, that's really the same. I mean, fundamentally, the reason is the same that we've just discussed, that outturn data, the rebound was much greater than we expected. You're right. Obviously, generally, you expect the forecast error to get closer to the date. And as I say, sometimes a bit of data can throw you off even quite late in the day. And I think that's what's happened there. So I think there's no guarantee that the forecast errors will always just sort of shrink as you get closer. In terms of, I'm not sure if you mentioned about the RTI monthly data, but I'll stop on that point unless maybe David Soane would like to add something.
David, you want to add anything?
Yeah, sure. So on the RTI data specifically, we have been watching this very closely since it first started being published. And what we saw in 2017-18 was that the RTI data actually appeared to be a very poor predictor of outturn data. There was quite a large difference between what the RTI data suggested was happening to income tax and what actually happened when we got the outturn data. So we were sort of reserving judgment on that one and trying to understand more about what was driving that difference. And I think we've made that point to you before and also in our statement of data needs. Now, what we've seen with the 2018-19 data, we had RTI data published alongside that as well. And the RTI data does now appear to be a better predictor, at least of the 2018-19 figure. So what we need to understand now is that a one-off, or is RTI a useful predictor for us in estimating changes in income tax outturn data? So we're still talking to HMRC about that and trying to understand more about it. We would certainly like to use RTI data more in our forecast, but we're still trying to understand more about this relatively new source of data and its relationship to what really matters, which is the outturn estimate of income tax.
Thank you, David. And just after I've asked this final question, I'll go to Murdo immediately after that. But just Just for the, again, for the record, and for those listening at home, can you just explain what RTI means? Because it's, we all get caught up in the language that we all understand, but so people appreciate what RTI.
I'll hand over to David Saulnier for that one, as he's the expert on this.
So it stands for real-time information, which is one of HMRC's systems for collecting and processing income tax data.
Okay, thanks. I just get that on the record so people at home who may be watching this know what's going on. Murdo. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Camino. Just waiting for my mic to turn on there. Good morning, Francis and colleagues. I wonder if I could ask a couple of questions again in relation to the supplementary forecast evaluation report on income tax, and just get a little bit more clarity and background. The first thing I wanted to ask about was figure 1.5, which is on page 9, which looks at the amount of money projected to be raised from the introduction of the five-band income tax system, which came in 2018-19. Now, if we look at the way you're projecting the income from this, it's been quite a substantial reduction in the forecasts. The forecast from February 2020 compared to the forecast from February 2018, and the gap grows in 2022-23 to 48 million, as against the originally forecast sum of 267 million, which is, you know, roughly, well, 20% of the original, which is quite a substantial drop on the figures you were originally forecasting 2 years ago. I was wondering if you could give us some background to that and explain why you have revised down your projections so substantially in terms of that new income tax banding.
Okay, I have to apologise. My phone just went off just then, so I missed part of the question. So I'll hand over to David Alf, who hopefully heard the question.
Okay, I think there are a number of different factors here. One is that it's part of the data issue we've been talking about up until now, that we've had a better understanding of what the data outcomes have been. And also the growth of income tax revenue hasn't been quite as strong as we were initially thinking, which will contribute to that effect there. I think we've also started to get more of an understanding of some of the impacts of distributional factors on the link between growth of income and the growth of tax revenue. And perhaps we hadn't fully taken account of the fact that by having a somewhat more progressive tax system, that in and of itself will start to contribute to growth of tax revenue in Scotland. Our understanding perhaps was not as full as it perhaps is now of what those effects are likely to be. But I think David Stone might have a better understanding of some of the detailed changes in forecast that you were referring to.
David?
Yeah, happy to talk about that for a bit. We're constantly updating and revising our forecasting models. And as a natural part of that process, the policy costings will move around a little bit. I think within this one in particular, we're comparing to the policy costing forecast from February 2020, which, as we've seen elsewhere, is when we revised down the overall level of income tax in Scotland following the publication of the 2017-18 data, which was lower than we expected. So bringing down the overall level of income tax revenues in our forecast, we also revised down the policy costing a bit. That's probably not the other factor. There'll just be some other changes within the model as well as we revise things like the number of taxpayers and different bands. What I would say is this is not a, I wouldn't say there was any one big factor behind the revision apart from perhaps the outturn data. And it's certainly not a new view on something like behavior change, which is still working in fundamentally the same way in this updated costing as it did in the previous costing.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much, David. Maybe I can ask a follow-up, which links nicely into what you also referenced there, which is the issue of the number of taxpayers in Scotland, which is referenced in figure 1.6. And there has been quite a substantial error that you acknowledge in the overall number of taxpayers, which is 33,000 fewer than you were previously predicting. I mean, that does seem quite a large number. Can you give a little bit of the background to that and why you think the number of taxpayers have fallen rather than increased, which is what you thought originally was going to happen?
Shall I come in on that one?
Okay, I'm sorry, I was muted for some reason. Obviously the key thing for the number of taxpayers is particularly the those who cross over from not paying tax at all to those coming into the tax system, and clearly changes in the tax system have changed the number of people who are not paying tax at all. And so that's where the changes have mainly been. And I think given that change, I think a fall in the number of taxpayers is entirely what you'd expect, if that answered your question.
Well, I think it does to an extent, but I think that only maybe accounts for half of the total, does it not?
Generally those who cross into tax areas is pretty hard to pin down precisely, because clearly very small changes in people's circumstances can take them in or out of tax. So I'm not sure how precisely we were ever estimating the number of taxpayers, particularly in that lower band. So I think that's because, you know, from our point of view, I mean, this, you know, that group is not contributing very much to the actual receipts, and therefore they're not, knowing whether someone's paying a very small amount of tax or no tax at all is not really something that figures enormously in our forecast. So maybe David Stowe might want to add on that.
Sure. I pulled out a figure the other day. So in Scotland, there are 268,000 people in the starter rate band in 2018-19, which is 10% of all taxpayers. So 10% of all taxpayers are within £2,000 of the personal allowance. So you can imagine that even quite small changes in the personal allowance can reclassify them from being a taxpayer to not being a taxpayer anymore. So our forecast of the total number of taxpayers are very sensitive to that. And similarly, around the higher rate threshold, there's a lot of people within that range, and even small differences in our estimate of exactly what the taxpayer's income is and how that changes relative to the higher rate threshold can reclassify taxpayers from one band to another. Although it's also important to recognize that because of the way that we construct our forecast, which is a detailed forecast of individual taxpayers' incomes, whether they're just above, say, the higher rate threshold or just below it, it doesn't have a massive effect on the income tax revenues, on the income tax liabilities that they have. But it does mean that you can get some volatility in the way that you classify them between one band and another.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thanks, Murdo. Can we now please to Angela Constance?
Thanks, Convener. Professor Breeden, I've got some questions on Social Security, but I appreciate they might be for Ms. Murdoch to answer. Obviously, it's still early days for the Fiscal Commission in terms of Social Security forecasting. So I would be really interested if you could plainly explain the implications about what happens when the Fiscal Commission get forecasts wrong, how you would rate your performance thus far, and whether or not you think it's advisable or contingency to be built into budget to take account of potential forecasting errors.
Okay. So I think you made a point, which is, you know, this is early days, and I think what we're very much in the learning phase in terms of security and how that works, because clearly, you know, when a new benefit or a new policy is introduced, the first year is obviously very difficult to forecast because there's lots of things going on, and as things bed down, they become easier. And similarly, as we even now, when new benefits come in, we've already learnt from the ones that have already introduced, so we know a lot more about we might expect about things like take up. So we're sort of hoping that our, you know, our performance will improve, but we will always have this problem when a new HIPAA policy is introduced. That's when the biggest errors are likely to occur. And then in terms of contingency, yes, I think, you know, that's a very fair point. You know, the budget process is difficult, and demand led benefits are obviously, you know, which is there and is has to be managed. So I think there is, you know, there is a sensible to try and have some buffers in the system to allow for those errors.
I see, Angela, I see Professor Ulf has also said he would like to contribute on that, I think, if I've got that right, David.
Yes, you have indeed. Thank you. Just to respond to the first part of your question, Ms. Constance, we do actually take this learning process very seriously. So we know we made quite some big mistakes in our early forecast of some of the Best Start grants. And we learned from that. We learned that we really had to understand in a lot of detail exactly how much resource Scottish Government was putting into promoting and advertising these new benefits. We listened very carefully to people from the Scottish Government, people from Social Security Scotland, about what their plans are for all of these new benefits. And we think very carefully about how to incorporate all that information into our forecast. So we think extremely carefully about all of these matters. And in terms of things like, say, the Scottish Child Payment, we have increased our estimate of the take-up, or forecast of the take-up rate, up to 80%, which is a very high rate of take-up. Now, we did that partly because of some of the effects of COVID, but we are now predicting an extremely high level of take-up of this.
Okay, Angela?
So following on from that, convener, we know that, you know, we're on the brink of economic upheaval, and it's a reasonable assumption, therefore, to make that there will be an increase in the number of people eligible for low income benefits. So it would be good to understand how all of that is factored in. But also, I'm aware that there is a reliance at times on DWP figures. Now, some of the comparable DWP benefits have lower uptake, whereas the Scottish Government actually has a legal duty to prioritise and promote update. DWP do mid-term alignment. I don't think the Scottish Government does. So how is all of these factors, how is Cognizance taking off all of that when the Fiscal Commission is developing models for forecasting for new benefits?
Yeah, so on the COVID effect, well, we're obviously already thinking about the impact that will have on various benefits, and that's something that we'll need to, you know, obviously look very carefully when we do our next forecast. And I mean, you're right. I think, you know, as David was saying, one thing we've learned is that it's very important to think about the, as well as the policy, what the communication plan has been in terms of advertising that benefit or whatever to the public, in order to understand how much money will be spent on it. And that's something that we now integrated much more into our forecasting process to discuss what the comms plan is for a particular policy, and therefore how quickly we expect it to be taken up, what level of take up we expect. So that's important. I think on your more technical question on the midterm, I might
I think you were trying to say that Claire's coming in, Francis. You broke up a bit there, but Claire, do you want to come in at this stage?
Yes, thank you very much. So just to come back on a couple of those points. So firstly, about the COVID-19 effects you're talking about. So we published an updated forecast of the Scottish Child Payment in September. And that was obviously our first forecast since February, where we were factoring the effects of COVID-19 in. So what we have assumed there is obviously there's a higher eligible population. We think that more families will receive universal credit and therefore be eligible for the Scottish Child Payment. So we think the effect of COVID-19 in 21-22, so the next financial year, will be £15 million of additional spending on the Scottish Child Payment. And obviously, when we produce our updated forecast of the Best Start grant, funeral support payment and other low-income benefits, we'll be also considering the effect of COVID-19 there. I think it's worth pointing out that the effects on these benefits, while significant on people, is actually in cash terms of the Scottish budget not that large in comparison in particular to the disability benefits, which account for a much larger proportion of spending. We do think there may be some COVID effects there as well in terms of DWP changing some of their processes. People, we've seen a reduction in some claims for disability benefits, but at the same time, we think some of the changes DWP has made will actually increase spending. So we'll be factoring all of that into our forecasts. In terms of the question about using DWP information, you're absolutely right. We had to look when we forecast some of these benefits at what was happening in the DWP systems before they were devolved. I think in particular, the Best Start grant replaced the Sure Start Maternity grant. We looked at what we thought take up was of the Sure Start Maternity grant. We assumed take up in Scotland would be higher. We, as David has said, we didn't assume it would be high enough. So we've subsequently increased our take up rate. So we look at those systems and we already think about what the government's doing and we're learning from that process, as David's already said. In terms of using more regular information as we're going now, we're getting some information from Social Security Scotland. We're getting some information from DWP on spending as we go, which we will consider how we can factor into our forecasts that are published in December. But I've covered quite a lot there. And I think David Ulf has got some more to add to my answer as well.
Yeah, that was quite a lot. But maybe David, shortly.
Just a short point. Going back to Angela's point about comparison with what's happening in the rest of the UK, we know that there's been a big uptake in claims for universal credit. There's been a sort of doubling of claims there. And people have asked questions about, would that lead to a doubling of the uptake of some of the benefits in Scotland? And we've looked at this quite carefully. And as far as we can see, a lot of the uptake in a lot of the additional claimants on universal credit are people who don't have children. So they would not become the people who would be claiming some of the Scottish benefits. So we don't think it would be appropriate to increase the number of potential claimants for some of these Scottish benefits by anything like the amount at which universal credit claimants are going up. So we have looked at this issue quite carefully.
Angela?
Thanks for that, Kavina. I think that's some interesting information about who's likely to take up universal credit. The only question that hasn't been answered is what are the implications when forecasting in and around Social Security is wrong? Everything else has been answered apart from that. What happens when you get it wrong?
Francis?
Well, I mean, there is a, I'm afraid it has to be managed in the budget. Again, I guess that's it's a difficult process, and particularly the coming year, it will be a very difficult process, and we appreciate that.
Yeah, indeed. Thanks, convener.
Okay, and Jackie.
Thank you very much, convener. A lot of the territory has already been covered by Angela, but just a couple of questions, because it strikes me in very pragmatic terms that one of the issues you faced was a delay in terms of launch dates being confirmed to you and communicated earlier. That strikes me as something that's relatively easy to fix. And what kind of practical arrangements do you have in place with the Scottish Government that you receive the earliest possible notification of these things? Because that obviously drives for a more accurate forecast.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, that's a very good point. I mean, you know, as I think we've said several times, we're all learning about this process, and I think our relationship with the government in terms of talking about introduction, talking about timing, as I said, as I already mentioned, talking about communication plans, really improved a lot. You know, we've just listened to the sense of, you know, we've got a good working relationship there. But I mean, it is, but launch dates are often, even in the best of times, launch dates can be a little bit variable due to, you know, events beyond anybody's control. So I think the issue of those, you know, we've certainly got, hope we've got a process that it means that there'll be more better communication about that. But even in the best of worlds, you know, those can change for reasons that neither side can necessarily predict, and therefore I think that'll be an ongoing issue, which, as I mentioned earlier, you know, new benefits are difficult even without that uncertainty about launch dates, but we appreciate that will continue to be a potential issue even with the strong relationship we have.
Yeah, absolutely, because if we can drive out those forecast errors, then, you know, it has less impact on the budget, which is the significant consideration for us. My final question on social security before I move on to something else, were about the assumptions you made for the Fair Start Scotland programme. Was that just based on data given to you by the Scottish Government, or did you actually look at programmes elsewhere to see, because there was quite a difference between the outturn figure and the forecast figure that you had in place?
Yes, so we took data from a variety of sources, you're right. So a lot of it was a very detailed discussion with the British government and with other sources. We made our own judgment on the basis of all that information. And as we've discussed, I think we, given what we've experienced, we would probably make a better judgment second time round. But, you know, that's in the process of learning about, say, particularly things like take-up, which is very hard in the first year of a programme. But as I say, particularly when that was pretty much the first programme we looked at. But we tried to get all the information from all the sources we thought were helpful, try and do that. Now we've got the experience of seeing a Scottish benefit introduced. So now hopefully we'll have a much better information base to make those judgments.
Okay, thank you. Can I go back to the territory explored with the convener about the Scottish income tax? Because as it currently stands, the cumulative impact of forecast and known reconciliations for the last 3 years from, I think, 2017-18 is about £700 million. Now, that's going to have a negative recurring impact on the budget going forward. So I listened very carefully to the response about the potential application of real-time information, because that clearly will make a difference to modelling. Does that enable you to revisit the forecast for 1920, or is this only applicable to future forecasting?
It is, yeah, I'm afraid, yeah, pretty close to future forecasting. So we, if I understand the question correctly,
yeah. Yeah, we're stuck with your estimate for 1920 as it stands then.
Yeah.
Okay. One of the reasons for negative reconciliations is a weaker performance in the Scottish economy relative to the UK. Now, you very helpfully explain in your report why growth in Scotland differed from your forecasts, but I'm interested to know whether you would make any analysis of why growth was lower in Scotland than the UK as a whole.
That's quite a big question. I guess there were, I mean, two big impacts, one of which is the population growth and demographics in Scotland being different, and that's one of the contributors. The other is the oil and gas sector, that, you know, the particularly things like investment in that sector has had an impact on other sectors around it. And so that the lower oil prices, lower investment have had an impact too. So I think those would be the two bigger things I would mention about that, the difference in growth performance.
Okay, thank you very much, convener.
Thank you, Jackie. Alexander Burnett, please.
Thank you, convener. And can I just note members to my register of interests regarding business rates? Professor Breeden, my question's on, you know, one of the smaller errors in the forecast, which is, you know, non-domestic rates. The error was 24 million, a relative error of 1%. which in forecasting terms is no doubt would normally seem pretty good. However, unlike other forecasts based on the number of taxpayers or turnover or those aspects, this particular tax is based on floor space, property space, which is obviously one of the most tangible metrics going. So I just wonder whether you could maybe give some explanation around this error and whether you think it's down to a small number of high value properties being demolished.
Yes, I think as I recollect, the issue in that tax is often the appeals process, and the timing of appeals is difficult. But I can maybe hand over to David Stern if he wants to add anything to that.
Yep, happy to. Yes, Francis is right. NDR as a tax base is very stable, and in a sense that makes it easier to forecast because it does just depend on the amount of floor space in Scotland, business floor space. However, appeals are quite, we can't really forecast how any individual appeal is going to turn out. All we can do is look at the history of the appeals process and try and judge what effect appeals might have on NDR revenues in the future. So actually, although we had a aggregate forecast error of £24 million, our error in the total of effective appeals on NDR revenues was £29 million. So that actually more than accounts for all of the error in our forecast.
Thank you. I mean, you have, and I've raised this question previously, you have focused on the appeals bit, but yet there are properties, business properties being destroyed. Surveyors in Aberdeen, they've compiled a list of properties that are about to be demolished, and they categorise it in sort of three aspects. They've got those properties which are formally declared to be destroyed with a total rateable value of around 11 million. That means a 6 million annual loss in rates. They're aware of a further 10 million of rateable value about to be destroyed, and there's a potential 10 million of rateable value beyond that, which they see as potential to be destroyed as well. My question is, how well cited are you of those sort of three levels that surveyors on the ground see in terms of predicting destruction of floor space and therefore the tax base?
I think it's fair to say that it's something that we haven't looked at in detail because, as Dave was explaining, our error is where it's coming from, and then we've focused our efforts on that. But I think that's useful insight you've given us, and we will certainly consider whether we should look into more into that data to help us improve that forecast.
Thank you very much.
Francis, I think both David Ulf and David Stone want to come back in. Yeah. Well, you can choose which one you want to come back in.
I think David Ulf should come first, I reckon.
There we go. David.
Well, I just wanted to reinforce the point that Max has just said, that we don't spend a lot of time looking at this destruction of rateable value, but that is a very useful insight that we should be focusing on for the future. We have been thinking a lot about the appeals because we know that's a big source of error, but there's far less we can actually do about that because it's just inevitably quite a random process as to how appeals turn out. So we know something about the appeals that are in the system, but when exactly they settle and how they settle is somewhat harder to predict. But it's a useful point that you've raised there.
Okay, well then, Alexander, anything else you want to pick up on, Alexander?
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Thanks, Dean. Thanks. Dean Lockhart.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I would like to ask about future forecast modelling to be used by the SFC for this current financial year and beyond, because given the fundamental impact of the pandemic on the tax system and policy measures such as the job retention scheme, how will the SFC change its methodology and modelling to forecast tax revenues for this year and beyond? And given the significant uncertainties involved, is there an increased risk of forecast error, which would be understandable, But given the uncertainties, is there a concern that forecasts for this current year might be subject to increased uncertainty?
Yes, I think that is a very fair point, that this is a very difficult period for forecasting, and I think inevitably forecast errors are going to be very large. You know, that clearly the forecasts that we made for what this year was going to look like are going to be very wrong because we didn't factor in the pandemic. And indeed, even after the pandemic, you know, the speed of recovery or whatever will also be hard. I think the one of the points, obviously, you know about, but it's just worth reinforcing, is obviously for the framework, it matters the errors that are made about the rest of the UK in the BGA forecast as well as our forecast. In this occasion, we're likely to have made, both us and the OBR obviously have made very similar errors, and therefore the important thing going forward is the relativity, i.e. of how Scotland performs relative to the rest of the UK, and also obviously how our forecast performs. So although there are very big errors going on this occasion, you know, we've had a few occasions when the error from the BGA and our errors have been going different directions. This occasion, we've been pretty sure that they will be in the same direction.
Now, I've got a couple of people want to ask something. Before I bring Patrick in, sorry, Dean, I should like you to conclude first.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I just had a brief supplemental, if that's okay. And I appreciate this might be a difficult one for the SFC to answer now, but I just wondered if there was operational data available for the time being, for example, uptake in the job retention scheme, that would indicate whether the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish income tax system might be less severe or more severe than elsewhere in the UK, or is it too early for the SFC to have an indication of that?
So for the data we have so far, our judgment so far is the impact has been economic impact has been relatively similar, but I think you make a very fair point. It's very early days, so we're still monitoring that very carefully in our use of sort of real-time data to try and spot differential impacts is increasing significantly, because clearly that is what is going to be important for the framework. So, but at the moment, our judgment is that we're not discerning any important differences yet. And therefore, the impact is slightly reduced. But maybe David Stone might like to add.
Yeah, so we're certainly making as much use of the high frequency data as we can, and the new data that's coming out, including the data on the job retention scheme. We'll be using that as much as possible in our forecast to sort of create a baseline. I suppose the critical point, though, is that we're trying to understand the effect of the pandemic on the economy and basing our forecasts on a view of that. But of course, the pathway of the pandemic from this point forwards is highly uncertain in and of itself. We can't predict how the pandemic is going to turn out over the next few years, and the outlook for the economy is very much tied to the outlook for the pandemic. So coming back to the start of that discussion, forecast errors are likely to be larger.
That's a response. Thank you. That's all I had, Convener.
Okay, Patrick Harvey, I think you've got a sup in this area.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I mean, just very briefly, I recognise that we've kind of moved on to looking ahead rather than looking back, which was the main purpose of the session. But as some of the witnesses will remember, I've previously asked questions about the way in which behavioural effects are worked into future forecasts and projections, and kind of questioned some of the assumptions about behavioural effects. Given that we're now living through a year unlike anything any of us can remember, surely it becomes not just difficult but impossible to work out in advance any kind of reliable forecast about people's behavioural changes, either in relation to work or other aspects of the decisions they make that will impact on the budget, like social security take-up. I mean, you said that the forecast error is likely to be larger, But that's just looking at the economic, the direct economic impact pandemic. Can you convince me in any way that there's a remotely meaningful way of trying to understand behavioural effects in a completely unprecedented year, which is affecting people's sense of security, their willingness to make changes in their lives, and even all of our mental health?
It is a fair point that behavioural effects, you know, they're all, this pandemic is, it's involving behaviours that we maybe, you know, are very unusual and very hard to forecast. So I would certainly say that, you know, that all aspects of forecasting, including behavioural impact, will be very hard in the next few forecasts. I still think, you know, that because we clearly are trying to make the best forecast we can, we will try and allow for behavioural impacts when we think are relevant. And equally, we will continue to look back over the historical evidence of other countries, but also historical data from Scotland, to see whether, you know, the sort of assumptions we make are borne out in historical data, so making us more confident to use them in the future. But I think, you know, it is a very fair point that this is, you know, forecasting. A lot of it is obviously based on historic experience, and we're going through a period which is not, you know, very rarely been experienced in history. So, so we haven't got much to go on a lot of these.
We lost you just a wee bit then.
You know, I'm not going to do the thing any further. Let's move on.
Okay, can I just ask a supplementary in this area as well? Because when somebody says to me that for truly understandable reasons, and that there are very large forecast errors potentially expected, and I understand why, that says to me, begins to create some alarm bells about what the potential impact will be on the level of spending available to the Scottish Government. Because if we've got forecast errors which are larger than normal, and the OBR forecast error is in the opposite direction to the forecast errors of the SFC, potentially, we're looking at a serious situation as far as the Scottish spending is concerned. So how best do you think we can, as a committee, reflect on that and ensure that we are at least in a situation to dampen anything that comes off a scale that creates a significant difficulty? I know that's a big question, but I think it needs to be asked.
So, even though we are expecting big errors, as I mentioned before, I think the likelihood is that the errors we make will be of the same style as the OBR makes. But of course, that's why the point I raised before, which is trying to work out whether the impact in Scotland is different from the rest of the UK, is actually a really important question going forward. If, you know, in some sense, as important as the actual overall impact. I think, you know, obviously there are going to be situations where the errors compound each other, but I think this is more likely to be a situation where the errors offset each other somewhat. But it is, again, you know, repeated, you know, it is going to be difficult for all parties, even with that concern. And I think we, you know, and if we get a differential impact in Scotland, then, you know, that will be quite difficult to manage.
I think David Elfo, if you don't mind, if Francis also wanted, you want to just see him in the chat
box. Exactly.
Yeah. I largely just wanted to reinforce the point that Francis was making there, that what's going to really matter for the Scottish budget is going to be the difference performance between the Scottish and the UK economy. And so far, at least in the aggregate terms, they have performed in a very similar way. I realise there could be some details that could matter at some point, but we've been looking at this quite carefully, and so far we don't see any significant difference at the aggregate level. And so this year, where the two errors have basically compounded one another, may not be repeated in future years. That's not a forecast. That's just something for you to reflect on. But it's just all the signs at the moment are that the two economies are going in the same direction. And therefore, the OBR is facing exactly the same challenges we face in forecasting. And if they're making errors in one direction, we're quite likely to be making errors in the same direction as well. But I would reiterate Francis's point that it's extremely hard to forecast what's going to be happening over the next year or so because of the way the pandemic's going to track.
Well, there seems a lot of hope in that. not necessarily certainty, but you understand. John Mason, please.
Thanks very much, convener. And if I could start with a couple of, going back to some of the points Murdo Fraser was making, a couple of supplementaries on that. He talked about the five-band income tax system and figure 1.5 in the paper, and that the comparison was between February 18 and February 20. But can you just clarify, is February 20 the actual figure? February 20 was quite a pessimistic prediction, I think, or forecast. So is that 48 difference for 22-23 the final figure?
I might pass over to David Stone on that. So
we'll never have a final figure for a policy costing. We can only ever estimate the effect on the economy. The figures provided in February 2020 are our latest estimates. The reason that we'll never have a final figure is because we're trying to compare how much tax revenues we know have been raised to how much tax revenues would have been raised with the previous system, which we can never know for certainty. We can only estimate that. Now that we've got final outturn data, we could come up with a better estimate of the 2018-19 policies using the outturn data, and we could look into that for our next report. So they might change again a bit. I wouldn't expect them to change radically.
Okay, thanks. Yes, I should have said latest rather than final, but that's helpful. Thanks. And another point that was raised was the number of taxpayers. Now, is there any evidence that, for example, taxpayer numbers have fallen because people have incorporated to avoid income tax?
We're not. I don't think we've got evidence on that. No, I think it's particularly the people in the coming into the starter band is where the most of the changes have happened. So unless one of my colleagues would like to contradict me or add, I don't think that's an important factor.
I'm not sure whether David Stone wants to contradict or compliment you.
I was just going to say, so we do get a fair amount of detailed modelling and numbers from HMRC on their estimates of incorporations in Scotland, and that's factored into our forecasts. At this point, I can't say whether or not those numbers have changed quite a bit, but I just don't think the scale of incorporations is really enough, or the variation in it is really enough to explain these numbers. I think the primary factor explaining these numbers is by far small differences between our forecast of the effect of the personal allowance on the very lowest earners compared to what actually happened in practice. I'd say that's the major factor behind this.
That's great. That's very helpful. Thanks. Now, we already mentioned real-time information, and again, can you clarify, does that only apply to PYE income taxpayers, or what about people under self-assessment, and how accurate are we with the self-assessment people?
I think that's another one for David Stone, I suspect.
RTI only relates to PAYE information. It's important to understand that people who file with SA may still have some PAYE returns as well. We might get some information about the SA community from PAYE, but there is not all of their tax comes through PAYE. So it's only a partial record of all of the income tax that's paid in Scotland. For self-assessment in particular, we don't really get a final figure for that population until we get the outturn data. There's no real timely way of monitoring self-assessment returns until we get the final outturn figure. But even within the PAYE information that we get, as I was saying earlier, we saw a difference between what RTI was suggesting was happening with PAYE income tax revenues and then what the outturn data said about it when the outturn data were published. So even within PAYE, we're seeing a bit of a gap between the two, and we're still trying to resolve that one so that we can make better use of the data.
Okay, thank you. Now, we've talked already about the relationship between the SFC forecasts and the OBR forecasts. Can you say anything about, are you both basing your forecasts on the same information? And also, when we had the analysis between SFC and that 83 million was the difference attributable to SFC and 207 million to BGA, are these agreed by OBR? Do they agree these figures?
So, yes, yeah, so in terms of the data, yes, we obviously have a very good relationship with OBR, and we share a lot of information and a lot of the same approaches. So that, and I think that's, you know, helpful to have that, right? Because as we talked about before, you know, it's the difference between our two forecasts that matters. In terms of whether they agree, I think this is sort of like a, I mean, what we've tried to do is give you illustrative breakdowns of where the errors come from, which I think are pretty sort of, you know, just mathematically, you know, just fall out. Now, you could break the errors down in different ways to you know, to show different information, because there was obviously a lot of moving parts in this. There's the base data, the growth rates of the, in the two forecasts. But I think how you choose to break up the data is up to judgment, but I don't think the actual break, you know, the way it's broken down is subject to dispute.
Okay, thanks. And the final area I wanted to move on to is the statement of data needs, which you produced. And I understand the OECD had a visit last year, and I think they said this is one of the most complex systems they know of in the whole world. I was interested in the previous requests that you'd made in Annex A, for example, more timely and detailed data on Scottish wages and earnings. And it says this is high priority, but there's been no progress. Can you make any comment on that?
Yeah. So, I mean, generally, I think the flavour of the statement of data needs is that actually a lot of progress has been made on a lot of the areas that we've asked about in the past. The earnings data is an outstanding request. It's a very, you know, and I don't think we could, you know, there's any fault in the sense it's just difficult that issue to be resolved. But that obviously for us is a very important bit of data to make our projections, and therefore it is we'd still like to have progress on that. So yes, I think on the company, yeah, that we wanted to raise in the data needs, you know, this time around is to say it's incumbent on us, but also on the Scottish Government to try and explain as simply as we can, you know, what is going on in the Scottish budget, because it is always complex, and it's becoming more complex as, you know, more moving parts are added. So I think that's something we wanted to highlight in the data needs document, which is, you know, all of us are going to have to work very hard to try and explain, you know, what is going on, and hopefully we will manage to do our part in that.
David Stone, my final point.
Sorry, I think David Stone also wanted to respond to that specific bit, John.
Yes, I was just going to say on the RTI data, so as well as giving us some insight into what's happening with income tax revenues, it also tells us something about employment and earnings as well in Scotland. So RTI certainly has a lot of potential to tell us more about earnings in a very timely way. And HMRC and ONS have been working hard on developing this as a source of information. But it is also quite new. We've been talking to them a fair bit about what they're able to publish and when, and it's in development, but that's going to take some time. And I think that the advent of COVID had an effect on some of the publication plans there as well. So we do have hopes and expectations for RTI, but it will take some time to come through.
Right, John, last point.
Yes, this is my very last point, again, from the data needs statement. I see the recommendation that for the fiscal frame review of the fiscal framework in 2022, there should be consideration that the Scottish Fiscal Commission should be given a statutory right of access to information from UK government departments. Does that suggest you're not getting that information at the moment? And is a statutory right, is that the way you feel we should be going?
So, I mean, as we say in the statement, I think the relationship with all these departments is really very good. So, not a sort of criticism. I think it's a statutory right makes it a easier process to get data. So we're not being critical of the relationships we have. I think we're just simply saying that it makes our job a lot easier if we have that statutory right. And that's why that comment is in there.
Okay, I think we finally go to Alistair Allen. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. You've outlined some of the challenges that there were in making predictions for the year 18-19. I wonder if you could say anything about what lessons you want to draw from that about making predictions for 21-22.
Well, as that's a very difficult question and I've answered quite a few, I'm going to hand straight over to David Al for that one.
Okay, well, one of the lessons we learned from 2018-19 was that we probably over-adjusted our forecast too much on the basis of the previous year's outturn data. So we will probably learn to place a bit less weight on just 1 year's data. And all the time we have systematic discussions about should we look at data over a longer period of time, how much weight should we give to the most up-to-date data. And that's an ongoing discussion we have all the time in relationship to all our forecasts. But we certainly learned a lesson from that particular exercise. I think the forecasting exercise here on in is so bedeviled by very different types of risks that the ability to learn much from past episodes, I think, is going to be very limited.
You've alluded there to some of the difficulties that there might be. Presumably, by the way, if you can't see me, I think it's a cloud going past the window. You've alluded to some of the difficulties that there might be. There's two very large known unknowns there, obviously, which are Brexit and COVID. Is there anything at all that can be done looking at 18-19 to try to make your prediction exercise flexible or deft enough to cope with those two unusual situations?
I think not a great deal. Obviously, Brexit, as with everybody else, we're waiting for the details on that. And so we're currently focusing on a sort of broad brush assumptions of ordered exit. But clearly, in the next few weeks, we're hoping to get more detailed information. But in terms of the pandemic, I mean, it is, we're having it once again to draw information from what. Not much from history, but more from recent history, but more from looking at other countries and more detailed research that people have done in about past and that sort of thing. So this is a very difficult forecasting period for that reason.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't see any other R's in the chat box. Therefore, can I warmly thank Francis, the two Davids, and Claire for their evidence today. That's the only item on our agenda, and therefore I now close this meeting. Thank you very much.